Okay, so hi everyone. My name is Paweł Skokosz, the nickname Piskok One, and we want to guide you through the workshop with a topic: build your own malware analysis pipeline using new open source tools. This workshop will be guided by three people: me and Paweł Pawliński. Paweł.
Okay. So hello, everyone. Yeah, we're mostly helping Pavel and also Jaroslav, who is going to join for the second part. So yeah, it's just a reminder that we are sending you the credentials. That's an important part of the information. For credentials for the MWDB service, that's one part of the workshop. So if you have not received these credentials, check your inbox. I just sent out a couple of emails very, very recently. And you will need this access to complete couple of the tasks. So if you have not received an email from us, please let me know. You can do this, I assume, also via chat, or and that's probably more suitable than Q&A. Yeah, that's if you cannot find this email, let us know, and in the meantime we'll help you with the access. I'll pass back to Pavel to carry on with the first part, and if you have any questions, please use the Q&A. We will try to answer the questions as they come. Also, in the meantime, so do not hesitate to post any questions, anything that you doesn't work, is not clear, or you just would like to have more information on. So thanks for joining, and let's start.
Okay, our workshop will. Technical problem. Okay, that's the agenda of our workshop. Workshop will be divided to the two parts. The first part will be about our MWDB service, which is in repository of data about malware, which is which can be accessed by any researcher that will register an account and will pass the vetting. The second part will be about the exact building malware pipeline using our open source tools, MWDB Core, which is the platform that MWDB CERT.PL is built on the top of. And Karton is our analysis backend, which also will be introduced in the further part of this workshop. A short reminder, make sure if all of these tools are working on your environment, because this will be required to do some tasks during this workshop, especially Python in the free version. Working Git client and Docker Compose with working Docker engine. So in the meantime, you can check if everything is fine with these tools. So let's start with the short introduction. What the heck is MWDB? Most of tools and services introduced in this workshop were for a long time just in-house tools. Just internal tools of CERT.PL. So they were built on based on our experience with malware research of various samples. And that's how begin every journey with malware research on a malware campaign. It starts just with some malware samples. And if you want to make a research on these malware samples, you need the malware reverse engineer who will analyze these samples and check carefully what these samples do. And as a as a result of this analysis, you will hopefully get lots of data about the campaign. Mainly the IOCs, but there are also some other information. For example, if you are tracking the CNC activity, you can get some comments, some traffic, and other data. So okay. Finally, as you proceed, as you are more advanced in the malware analysis, and as time goes by, the scale also goes up because there are more campaigns, more samples, sometimes similar to the previous ones. So you need to link them in each other because multiple families and different types of malware can be used by the same actor, for example. And as you can scale up the analysis process, for example, by automation, which will be introduced in the second part of the workshop, or by hiring more malware analysis researchers, you still need to deal with the growing amount of data, which is when your automation is advanced, this data can be distributed along the various analysis services. So we need to join everything together and store somewhere. And that's why we created the malware database service, which at the beginning was just a place where we stored the static configuration, the most basic form in CERT.PL of data about the malware. These static configurations were mostly gathered automatically, and that was the place to store them and look for some and search some special things in this repo. So the name was further shortened to MalwareDB, and finally it was shortened to MWDB. And as the MWDB was growing, we found out that the malware research is not these data are not used only by the malware researchers. The IOCs are useful also for other IT security people, like threat intelligence teams, who are also interested about the IOCs, by security operations center, or other CERT teams like us. So the MWDB quickly becomes the interface between the malware researchers and malware analysis systems, and the other people who are tracking the actual actors who are doing threat intelligence and other job on this data. So that's how we started to open that service much wider than before, and we started to make it more public than before, and not just an internal CERT.PL tool. So the first part of the workshop will be the tour through the MWDB CERT.PL service. And the first thing that might be useful for you is training materials on the github.com CERT.Polska training MWDB, where you can go through the following exercises without waiting for me, but I will go through every exercise, so I will guide you if you have any problem. Okay, so first of all, let's start with logging into the MWDB CERT.PL service. It is available on the page MWDB CERT.PL, where you have the login form. Okay. So Pavel, could you say something about the credentials?
Yeah, so there were a couple of people also that told us that they did not receive credentials. So hopefully now everyone has access to that. And yeah, if there is still kind of anyone that has not got credentials yet from us, please send us a message on the chat. And we will send you back an email with the login and password for this. But yeah, I hope that everyone is has access now. So if you don't have access to MWDB, let us know.
Okay. So I will give you some time to log in.
Okay, so I also posted the link to the materials on the chat for everyone to make it easier. The slides are not interactive.
Yeah.
On the GitHub, you'll have the information, especially on the hands-on parts of the training. But we will go through all these tasks also on the screen. But if you would like to move a bit quicker than what we are showing here during the workshop, then just feel free to complete the tasks in advance. It's really you can interact with the system. You have sufficient permissions to query the data, so it should be possible for you to complete all the tasks if you don't want to wait for the explanations here. Okay, Pavel, back to you.
The first thing I want to show is just the interface of MWDB. So even if you have the problems with the login, as I can see in the chat and Q&A, until they are resolved, you can just see what's happened on the screen, and I will show you the interface of the MWDB. Of course, if you are already logged in, you can check some things on MWDB on yourself to get familiar with it. So don't worry, you can click on everything you want. And okay, let's start. So the main view in the MWDB CERT.PL service are the recent files, files that were recently uploaded to the MWDB and are available to all people. Because to MWDB you can upload file privately or publicly, and these are the public ones. So what we have here, we have each row tells us about each file. We have the size, type. Every field is can be copied to clipboard, so we can use it in the query field. And actually, the most important thing in this view are the tags, because the tags inform us about the type of the sample and possibly the recognized family. So, for example, let's find the that's pretty rich. Based on tags, we can tell, for example, that this sample was is recognized as form book based on different criteria, like ETP rules that were used for the traffic during the analysis in sandbox, the IR rules, and that we have successfully ripped the static config from this sample. And that is the drop of the other malware, which is called GooLoader. So the tags are pretty rich, and you can make some filtering based on these tags. For example, if you want to find all runnable samples, .exe, and check all GooLoader drops, you can just click on the tag, and you will go to the query, which show you all the samples that are .exe files and GooLoader drops. You can also toggle out some tags, like, for example, let's say we don't want ripped phone book. So you can click on this crossed circle sign. And we have some quick queries, which are useful for some wildcard filters. Even if we don't want to show the ripped phone book samples, we can just click this button and we will check for not ripped phone book, but any ripped. And we can find out that GooLoader drops, for example, non-occur RAM cross agent Tesla. So the other families than only just the phone book. But let's go further. As we can go to the sample. And here is some detailed information about the sample. The most basic information are the size type, the hashes, SSD. Of course, MWDB doesn't have fuzzy search, so it's not as useful as you may want to, but we are still calculating that, so you can use it for other purposes. The first upload time, once again, the tags, related objects, which will be described further, and some custom attributes, which are some IOCs related with the sample, or the reference to the Karton analysis, which will be also described before. And in addition, we have some comments, just like in the virus total, you can put there some extra IOCs or extra information about the matched things related to this sample. Okay, let's come back to the left side. We have the multiple tabs, for example, relations, which shows us things, the objects that are related with this file. So for example, you can click on the config and you can show the next relations with this file and this config. So it's expandable if you want. And the preview where you can see the contents of the sample along with the hex view, which is more useful for the binary files. And finally, you can download the sample. Oh, it's dangerous. Oh no. Okay, so that's the short introduction. Of course, you have also other types of objects like configurations and blobs, but these will be described in the next part, and the upload. Okay, so that's the short reminder about what we said. And the search has additional nice feature. So even if you don't know the query syntax yet, you can copy the hash and just paste it here and click enter. So you will be redirected to the file with that hash, which may be useful for the next parts of the exercise. So if you are looking for the exact hash, you can just paste it here and find the exact sample. Okay, so let's go. Exercise first is related with the most basic type of filtering, which is filtering samples by tags. Okay, so let's tell a bit more about these tags. As a part of the exercise, you should start with clicking on tag starting with runnable to get only runnable samples. And then you have some samples from external feeds. So you may search for example, feed malware buzzer and say, okay, I don't want to see any samples from malware buzzer, no offense. And click on the circle to filter them out. And finally, we are most interested about the recognized and ripped samples. So toggle in the only ripped option. Okay, and it just works. We have some Fumbook, Raccoon, samples, Azerold. And let's check what we have in the query box. As you can see, there is some kind of grammar. And you may be already familiar with this grammar because it's the Lucene syntax, which is quite popular. And let's say a bit more about this grammar. MWDB uses the subset of Lucene syntax. So you can't do everything you can normally do with Lucene, but it's still based on this language. So if you are already familiar with that syntax, you should feel more familiar with the queries. And there are three main elements of the query, which are conditions that consist of field and value. So you can filter for some field being that exact value. We have operators and, or, and not. That must be uppercase because that's the Lucene requirement. Keywords are uppercase. And we have the wildcards. So for example, you can put wildcards anywhere in the string and you will get and you will match any string that is in this place. So for example, we have the wildcard here. So we want to match any tag that starts with ripped and not just the concrete ripped tag. Wildcards are pretty useful also with tags, not only for the common prefix, but also, as you can see, phone book, for example, can be classified based on different things like ET Pro or Yara. So if you want to look for anything that is related with phone book, you can just wrap the phone book route with this asterisk. So we will check for all things that have phone book, something tagged with phone book inside. So as we So it works because we have both the phone book tag itself and things that contain the phone book. So it might be also useful, for example, if we can't read the actual phone book config, you might still look in for other phone book samples, use this tag to use this query to search everything that looks like phone book for our systems. Okay, and the next thing is that you might already notice that the tags are colored, and that color is determined by the type of the tag. So, for example, the red tags are just the tags that doesn't have that are simple, that consist of single words, for example, phone book. And these tags are the oldest ones and are mostly used for marking artifacts that are associated with Malware family. So, for example, that's how we mark the phone book artifacts, which are, in this case, dumps with unpacked phone book code. The second tag begins with feed and are describing the source of malware sample. So we have different sources, like files downloaded based on URLs from Urhaus, malware bazaar feeds. Actually, we can see these feeds just by typing. Everything that is from feed. And by toggling out the actual feeds, we have Malware Bazaar, we have Urhaus, and we have other ones like Malware Traffic Analyzer, so or something called Sample that comes from our internal systems. Okay, the third important one is the tag marked with ripped. That is for the original sample, indicating that we have something recognized and we were able to rip the static configuration from that sample. These are the most interesting ones in MWDB. And then we have two other tags, the gray ones that are describing the type of the sample and some generic metadata tag with additional information based on the specific class, like this sample was matched by our variable called like that. These rules came mainly from the YARA signator from Malpedia. So you may already know these ones. And the syntax is pretty rich. Even it's just a subset of Lucene. We, for example, support the range queries. So you may find the samples with specific size within a specific range, and you have multiple ways to do that. And the same for upload time. If you are looking for samples from the specific period of time, you may use the same syntax for checking the date and time of the sample. Like, for example, if you want to check for samples that are from between of the January and February of 2020, we can just use this query and we get in the descending order all of the samples. And you can also, of course, do more filtering on this list. So it's, I recommend just to play with the query, with this syntax, because it's pretty verbose, I think. And for that, you may go to the official documentation of MWDB where there's a chapter about the Lucene search, which describes the whole syntax. Oops. And it describes also some advanced queries based on relationships. So if you want, after the workshop, you may read that chapter to know more about the Lucene used in MWDB. Okay, so if you have any questions about this part, you may use the Q&A. If you don't have any, we can go to the next exercise called Exploring Sample View and Hierarchy. So I want to remind you that, on the top of training document, you have some cheat sheet with the hashes and other links that will be starting points for the next exercises. So you can, for example, for exercise two, number two, you can just copy that hash and paste into the search, because we will be working on the sample in this exercise. Okay, so if you already copied the hash, we may continue. Okay, so what we know about the sample? We know that this is a raw archive from Malware Bazaar, and in attributes we have both analysis data and link to the feed Malware Bazaar. So you can check the other information from Malware Bazaar here. And let's explore the relationships. Here we have related samples, and these samples are the things that were unpacked through this archive by our analysis backend. So that's the file that was contained in the archive. And okay, we can go to that child, clicking on the child, and we have the malware binary sales order description.dxz that was recognized by multiple ways as a form book. So okay, that's the original sample that was in the archive and was recognized as a form book. And we can go further to the next sample. And we have a dump. These dumps are not, these dumps are special because every sample is analyzed dynamically in our sandbox, the ArcVault sandbox. And we are doing multiple dumps based on various heuristics. The point of these dumps is that we want to unpack the sample, because every sample comes in packed form in most cases. We want to get the unpacked code, the unpacked part of the sample, which contains the actual code that is executed by the malware. And we generate multiple dumps, but we are choosing only the best candidate to upload to the MWDB that contains the most complete malware configuration. So we don't upload all the dumps, because most of them are just a noise, but we are choosing the single dump that should contain the most complete unpacked code for this malware. And this candidate is based on static configuration. What is static configuration, you may ask? Okay, so let's go to the configuration. Static configuration is the, okay, how to say that? Malware code It's just some code that have some possibilities inside. So for example, can do various things based on comments got from the CNC. And that kind of malware must be configured somehow to make it usable for the criminals. And each malware contains such a configuration. For example, to tell the malware where is the CNC server, or what are the encryption keys, etc. So we are trying to rip this configuration from the malware to tell how this malware code was configured by the criminal and what IOCs we can get from this malware. And as you can see, for phonebook, we have some decoy domains and the URL of the CNC. And based on the relationships, we might observe, okay, let's zoom in. We may say that we may observe that multiple dumps contain the same configuration. And as you can see, we have various original samples that we can expand behind that. Some malware samples even unpacked to the same portion of unpacked code. But because all of these samples are configured the same, so they are asking the same CNC server with the same credentials, et cetera, we can tell that all of these files we can see here are just different polymorphisms of the same malware because they are configured the same. So if something is configured the same and is most probable in the same version, we may tell that all of these samples are logically the same sample. So that's how the static configuration is really important for the MWDB, because it's used not only to contain some IOCs, but also to tell that various samples in the MWDB are logically the same sample, because they all contain the same configuration, but with slightly change code or the packing or the packer or used compiler. So okay. The objective of this task was to show you the relationships. And do you have any questions at this time? So if not, I will show you a short summary. So in MWDB, we have a hierarchy of sample, which is usually the archive, if there is an archive, the original sample, which is usually packed, and the memory dump, which should be the unpacked core of the malware. And finally, we have the extracted malware configuration that logically represents such a malware. And all of these things are related, have the setup relationships in the MWDB. So you can tell that all of these things are logically the same. Okay, but as we can say that these things are not different, we have sometimes similar configurations that are different, but in but still within a single campaign, things may be configured similarly based on some patterns used by actor. And the third exercise will show you how we can see the how we can search for the similarities in configurations and how we can explore the configurations. And the important things and the important thing is that every configuration is just a JSON object. It's parsed by the MWDB and treated specially, but it's stored just as a JSON. And you can see this JSON in preview. The only special thing with this JSON is that we use a special hashing algorithm. So lists are hashed non-order-wise. So if domains, in case that domains were ripped in different order, for example, some domains are displaced by the ripping script, the configuration hash will still be the same. So if list contains the same elements, it is treated the same by the MalwareDB. So if you upload, for example, permutated decoy domains, you will get the same object and the same relationships. But let's check if we have other configurations with the same URL. So all the blue colored fields things are clickable and are redirecting you to the search that will look for other objects with the same value of the element. So let's click on that URL, and you can see that there is only one config formbook that contains the following structure. In the URLs list, there is an URL object with this value, and there's only one object that meets that requirement. But we can see that, but we can check, for example, if that path was reused in other configs. So we can replace that part with a wildcard and check what's the result. And hey, we have two configurations. There is another configuration which contains just the URL without decay domains. But the URL is also slightly different. And it's also unique in the database. But we may ask ourselves a question whether that pattern of the path was used by other malware, for example. And here we have the full text search in JSON object. Because now we are looking for the exact field, but we can remove this part and leave just the CFG field and add the wildcards as before with tags. So we'll get the full text search in all configs looking for the /COD/. And let's check what happens. Okay, we got the phone book once again. So it was not so useful. But we may look for other things, like for example, the LAN TLD, which was used in both configs. And okay, we have much more. Also, most of them are phone books, but we have also some Gunscraps and Agent Tesla. Let's take a look at Agent Tesla. And okay, it's not a .land TLD. It's just a .land in the config, because the rule is the same as we go to the preview, press Control F and type the .land. And as you can see, these fields are matched by this query. But we can improve our query and add, for example, a block quote. But this block quote must be escaped by the backslash, because we have our value part already wrapped in the slashes, in the block quotes. And check what happens. Okay, we have slightly less results, but they should be more exact. For example, let's check the grant cap. There are lots of domains, but you can still go to the preview and use Control F to find the .land domain. And we have the domain we were looking for. So the full text search is also very useful. For example, if we are looking for the exact domain, we have the IOC and we want to know if this IOC occurred in one of the configs. We can just use this full text search pattern to look for it. For example, okay, let's say google.com. And now, okay, we have google.com in GoloDev because it uses the type google.com to grab the samples. Okay, so that was the fight exercise, looking for similar configurations based on the content.
So maybe I can just add a bit that for people that are familiar with other services like VirusTotal intelligence or services from other vendors, you can find some similarities that especially with like when you can pivot based on various properties of the file. I think if you compare it to like commercial vendors, obviously we have not the number of samples in the our instance at CERT.PL is of course much lower, and also we don't have that much metadata, but the static configurations are I think something that is very, very important part for us, and it's quite I think quite rare to have that kind of information in other services, which typically offer kind of more behavioral information that of course can be also used for pivoting, but with the static configurations it's kind of much more certain, especially as you could see this, for example, these decoy domains, which are kind of clearly visible in the static configuration. During behavioral analysis, they would not be distinguishable probably from the real CNC domain. So it's if you have any questions kind of regarding comparison or functionality, again, there is a Q&A. Functionality in Zoom that we recommend you to use. So sorry for interrupting, Pavel, and giving the floor back to you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for the explanation. So the configurations have also the next advantage. These data have pretty high confidence, because they were ripped directly from the malware. So that's what malware have exactly contained. So there may be some red herring, like in the name, I think pretty interesting, because it usually contains the fake hosts part with chapter comment carfax com, which is pretty characteristic for the naming. But the other parts, like public key and the URLs, which are it might be an error on the criminal, made by the criminal. Okay. These data have pretty high confidence. So it's not based on the pickups, on the communication. It's got directly from the internal configuration embedded in the malware. But there are two difficult parts of ripping malware like that. The first thing is that you need to analyze the semantics of the field, because it's the configuration isn't in the human readable format. It's more like binary format, and very often is just a references in the code to some strings that are in the malware. And the difficult part is to assign the semantics of the string to the actual role in this malware. So usually we are trying to be good at it, but there are cases that we have the string and we can't assign the appropriate key to that string. So that's the one of the purposes of the third type of object in MWDB, which are blobs. So the blobs are the third type. And internally, as configs were the JSON objects, blobs are just a text files. They are also important data, but unstructured ones, because we don't have structured objects with key value assignment, but just a text file with some random blob that was ripped off the sample. But these blobs have also a strict meaning, special meaning in the system, because it's not just a strings command made on the dump. Very often, we have the strings that are imported from malware and contain the parts of static configuration are usually secured by encryption and special encoding or other type of obfuscation. So if we are able to match the decryption routine, the obfuscation routine, because these strings must appear as a plain text during the execution, by checking the XREFs, the cross references, we are often be able to decrypt all the meaningful strings in the malware without knowing the exact semantics. So that's what's made for Doremcos. We have the configuration, which is a bit limited. In that case, CNC address, but all the other previously encrypted strings are contained in the blob where they are listed. So okay, let's go to the blob which is in training MWDB document. That one. And that's the agent Tesla blob that was shown before. So as you can see, we have some strings. They are pretty useful though, even if they don't have Zend semantics, because we have some registry keys, we have user agents used by malware, we have some domains. So we can still use this data as a bunch of IOCs, for example, if you filter that. But what's the important thing is that if you go to the second blob, the rank-cost one, and once again go to the parent, you can see that these strings, this blob is somehow linked to the configuration. And if you go to the preview to see the JSON, you may see that even if the config is pretty poor and have only C2 element, which contains the host and the credentials, which are empty, the raw configuration, the hash of the raw configuration of the blob is also a part of config, and it's also a part of value that is hashed to identify the configuration, to prepare the configuration identifier, which should be unique. Why we do that? To answer that question, we should do the same thing as in the previous exercise and go to the CNC part and look for the similar hosts. And as you can see, we have two different configs with the same host, but we have different row configuration. Okay, but this blob is pretty huge. Okay, it's just a plenty of lines, but it may be difficult to compare it visually. And what we want to do here is to compare these two blobs from these two configurations that are containing the same CNC. And how we can do that. Okay. Let's get this hash to the clipboard by clicking copy value to the clipboard button. Okay, and then we can go to the second config, and as we can see, we have different hash. So let's go to the blob. And the very useful option in MWDB is diffwith, where we can check the difference between two blobs. And as we click that button, we are redirected to the recent blobs, but with that original div assigned. And we can search for the similar blob we want to compare with. So to do that, just paste the copied identifier to the query field and press enter. And after choosing the blob, we'll be navigated to the comparison view where you can see the difference. And as you can see, there are two differences between these blobs that make this configuration unique. Because even if we don't have assigned semantics to this field, they are still making the configuration different because it's another generation of the malware. This rank-cost bot have two strings different that are used internally and may be crucial to the communication and, for example, send commands by the CNC. So that's the first purpose of blob, where we can show some data in unstructured form because the structuring is too difficult, for example, for this type of malware. or is just some proof of concept of ripping script and not everything is implemented yet. I think that's the case of MCOS. But there are also other blobs. In blobs, you may store everything you imagine. Everything is useful for you as a text file. So for example, we have a field blob type. And while all of these string, static string parts are marked as raw config, we may want to add the not condition to the query and find that we have also other types of the configuration. We have lots of mirrors here, so maybe it would be nice to filter them out. And hey, we have, for example, some Hansitors. Let's go to the Hansitor dynamic configuration. Okay, I will show the query for a bit longer. You can check if you have the same on your screen. And we are going to the blob under this link, 3B03. So okay, let's see what's in this blob. As you can see, we have some comments sent from CNC. And an URL to the second stage of this malware. So underneath of the MWDB, we have some tool that was presented before on some conferences called mTracker, which simulates the bots, simulates the malware communicating with CNC, and tries to scrap the comments that are sent by the CNC for that exact malware configured by the ripped configuration. So in that case, we have got a comment to download a second stage from that link. So okay, we have downloaded that malware and uploaded to the MWDB as a children of that blob, because that sample is related with that act of communication. And we have a second stage that is most probably the Cobalt Strike. And if you go to the relations, you may see that it was downloaded by various other comments that are containing the different URLs. And all of these URLs are also listed as a from attribute of the downloaded second stage. Let's come back to the relations. Okay, maybe zoom it in to make it more convenient. There's a lot of objects here. And now we can see the chain. From a bunch of files of Hansitor samples, we went to the dumps with unpacked core, with the unpacked code of the malware. So we were able to get the configuration. And based on configuration, we were able to, and configuration and the reverse engineering, we were able to re-implement the Hansitor bot and communicate with CNC to get the comment and the sample that was used as a second stage in that campaign. If you go to the config, you may see that it's just a user agent that is probably checked by the CNC, the build version, and the URLs of the CNCs. And that message probably comes from the older version of the mTracker. So yeah, we are tracking these buttons because we have the data. The other thing that might be pretty interesting is that for the same configuration, we have only one URL. So probably that URL that is sent from the CNC depends on the config. Even if all of these URLs for all of these configurations are downloading the same file. So that's pretty interesting. That maybe the comment is assigned strictly to the one part of the configuration. Okay. So that's the transitor. But we have also other types of dynamic configurations. Let's do the same thing. So we don't want to have raw configurations. We don't want to have any MIUIs in our results. And hey, the nice part is that you can store that query as a custom quick query, which you can name not raw configurations and not MIUIs. And you have another quick query that is reusable. So we don't need to type this multiple times. And okay, we have seen the transitor. Let's see the chronos. That might be interesting. And what you have here is the injects. Because the CNC send us some injects that are used in the main browser attack, because Kronos is a bunker that is pretty famous. So you can go through this data and use them, for example, for signatures. If you are the bank and you have the anti-fraud system, for example, signature-based. So that's pretty interesting. And if you go to the relation, you may see that with this configuration, we have related multiple injects. For example, that one. And there's also a drop, which is the jar file. So the CNC send us both the injects and some next stage. I don't know what exactly it is, but it's pretty small, pretty interesting. We may also look for other Kronos drops. Okay, there is a bug with that part, but it will be fixed in the next version. So sorry about that. We may go manually to the samples and check this tag and see the other Kronos drops. Well, we have some good work here. Okay, maybe these samples are just some red herring, and they are not the real second stages. But it's still useful to track them. Oh, okay, we have something interesting. For example, one of the Kronos drops was the red line trial, and we have some signatures from the agent Tesla. So hey, that might be interesting. So as you can see, these drops are assigned to the configuration, because the configuration is the logical representation of the malware. So all of these dumps, all of these original samples should behave. Okay, we have the same code. Should behave the same and do the same communicating with the CNC and getting the data. So the responsibility of the developer of configuration repair is to get these fields of configuration that are meaningful for the communication. So that configuration can represent the actual bot, the communication process. So you can you are completely free to explore the MWDB now. As you know, all of the object types. And let's summarize it. Because malware configuration is the logical representation of the of the malware, of the bot, we can assign dynamic malware configuration that was fetched from the CNC and contains, and in this act of communication, we may receive the next state malware, some updates, some comments, web injects, etc. And also in blobs, we may have the unparsed part of static configuration. That's also logically a part of malware configuration and is somehow embedded in this configuration. But it's an unstructured object. So just for the convenience, we don't have it in the JSON because it can be multi-lined. And we have it in a separate object with just a hash in the actual configuration JSON. Okay. Okay, but that's just the exploration of the existing data. Okay, we have, I don't know if lots of data, but plenty of data in our MWDB. By the way, you can go to the statistics tab, where we have the statistics of unique configs by the family. So we have plenty of families, but within the 24 hours, we have only plenty of them. And of course, you can click on the, for example, NetWire and check the NetWire configurations. But the important thing is that everything you see from your first 22 accounts is that all of these data are public. Of course, not completely public. They are not TELPE white, but TELPE green is the TELPE level that you may assume. So it's open for all the MWDB registered users, all of the participants of the community. But sometimes you may want to upload something privately. You may not want to share your sample with everyone, but you may still want to get the information about this sample from MWDB. Of course, you need to keep in mind that everything you upload to the CERT.PL is visible for the CERT.PL. So even if you mark the sample as private, we are still able to access that sample. So that's pretty obvious, I think. But for other users, for other companies, for other organizations, it will be hidden. And how does it work? How does work the sharing model? So OK, let's start with the upload tab, where you can upload the sample. We have prepared a special sample for you. Okay, the X5 malware zip. You can download it from the train MWDB catalog if you cloned this repository. Or just download it directly from the GitHub. So okay, let's download it. It's zip packed and with passwords infected, so it shouldn't trigger your antivirus software. But you don't have to unpack it before the upload, because MalwareDB is able to recognize the infected passwords, the archives with infected passwords, so it will be unpacked by the MWDB. So let's download it and check if. Okay, I see that Windows Defender likes it, so no problem. And go to the upload and drag and drop that file to the drop zone. And okay, let's explore the upload view. Here you can type the parent identifier if you want to assign that sample to the specific parents, but we don't want to do that here. And there are plenty of sharing options. The default option is all my groups. And the answer, what are my groups, is in the groups tab, because all of your accounts are members of the same organization made for workshop, first 2020. So that's your colleagues, and you can share your sample with your colleagues from the same organization. And the default is to, yeah, Pablo said on the chat that unless the data is already available on the internet, yes. Okay. So by default, we are sharing that sample with all of our organizations, usually the same, a single one that is as a, that is related with your company. If your company wants to have an organization, it's not a default that we are making such an organization. If you want to share some files with your colleagues from the same work group, you can ask us on the Slack or by the email to create such a group for you. So okay, we can as well share something with a single group. We have only one group, it's 2020. The everybody option adds the sample to the public feed, so the other users can see it. And we can jealously share the sample only with myself, so nobody is able to see that sample except the CERT.PL employees. Okay, so let's choose all my groups. Let's share it with all my work groups, all of the first 2020 participants. Okay, file uploaded successfully. And as you can see, the first thing is that Karton analysis already happened because the sample was known for MWDB. And we are doing the analysis only when sample is new, only if sample were not recognized before. And the raw analysis can be triggered only by the CERT.PL. So if you think that you may achieve better results for a sample, you should inform us that we should perhaps reanalyze that sample for better results, because the CNC, for example, became active and can drop something crucial for the analysis. So okay, what we can see here? Our zip was unpacked. It contained the RAR. And in this RAR, we have Agent Tesla malware, which was unpacked, and we generated the configuration. And the same configuration was in other public samples. And okay, wait. Who sees my sample? And the answer is in the shares box. As you can see, the sample is visible only for the uploader, which is me, myself, the first 2235, and the first 2020, and our organization, because we chosen to upload for the organization. And I wasn't the first one because the user 26 has uploaded it before. So we all see that sample, and only and we are the only ones who see that sample. But the child, okay, child is also unique. So that RAR is also unique for our case. But the file in the archive, okay, it is also visible only for us. But the dump, wait, something is wrong here. Okay, maybe it generated a different dump. Okay, but the other dump related with the configuration is public. So how does it work? How does the how does the access inheritance works in the MWDB? So the rule is that we are sharing with you all the descendants, all the children that are related with your sample. So you can see all the results. And if your sample is public, we are also sharing all the resulting objects with public. But the important thing is that we don't share the parents. So even if your unique sample has been ripped to the configuration, the configuration origins will be still private or public depending on how the origin was uploaded. So if a sample may contain some information that is a bit sensitive for your organization, of course, if something is sensitive, you shouldn't upload it to the MWDB. But if you are afraid that something may be leaked for the other users, don't worry, because if you are the only uploader of the sample, for example, the XLS or some dropper that is prepared for our organization by some APT group, for example, we don't share it with the others. We only share the things that are common for the various origins. So the permission inheritance is only to the children's. It's not backwards to the parents. It's not done backwards. So as you can see on slides, that's the short explanation. If the Charlie uploads C and the Alice uploads the A, which is originated from the C, because Charlie, for example, added such a relationship, and Bob uploads B, which is also originating in C, that doesn't mean that Bob and Alice see the C file. It only sees the subtree that is related with the sample. And the child sees the whole tree because he uploaded the topmost sample. So he sees all of the tree. And the share box shows you what's the inheritance and what samples are shared with who from your groups and why. And the grayed out fields are the inherited entries. So for example, in the MWDB, we may see that this file is shared with us because that file was uploaded by 1st 2026. And if we go to the sample, we are seeing the origin. And going further in the tree, traversing to the config, we may see that it's a public config because that file was uploaded by the abuse.ch. But we are also the kind of owners of this config because we uploaded that file. So that should be pretty transparent for you. Even if the shares, well, we are working hard to make this a bit more understandable for people who are not familiar with the sharing model. For example, by some color marks, if the sample is public or not, and why. But it's still a very useful information for you if you want to check the visibility of a specific object in the MWDB. So okay, that's the end of the UI part. Now we will do some programming related with the MWDB lib binding. So the Python will be required for that part. And okay, the first thing you should do as a preparation is to create a virtual environment by using this command. And don't care about my host name because it's just some trolling of our admins. So don't feel abused. Sorry for that. Okay, so let's start with the with virtual environment. And what we need to install in that virtual environment is to install the MWDB lib CLI. CLI is the extra dependency that is required to have the command line interface working. And for our convenience, we may also want to install the IPython shell. Okay, let's install that in our virtual environment. And meanwhile, let's go to the sixth exercise, which is getting information about recent files using MWDB lib. And okay. That thing is described in two places. The first place is the MWDB with the docs, where you have convenient user guide that describes all of the MWDB features. And one of the features is REST API, which is provided by MWDB. And here you can do the same steps as during this workshop. So if you want to write some scripts for MWDB, that might be helpful for you. And the second thing is the actual MWDB lib documentation for developers, which is under MWDB DB lib with the docs.io. And here you have the API of the library documentation. So that may be useful for you if you want to explore the methods that can be used with this library. So that's the two places that you may want to visit when you want to write a script from MWDB. Okay, we have installed our library. Okay, maybe I will try to zoom in the window. Okay, I don't see that. Okay. I hope everything is visible for you. Okay, and let's start with the MWDB lib. By importing the MWDB lib library from MWDB lib library, we will import the main MWDB lib binding class. So that object is our session object that provides the methods to work with API. So let's create the object called MWDB. And the first thing we need to do is to log in, is to start the session. So after you enter the login, you can provide your username and the password. I will use my personal account. And that's the warning, because in scripts, you should use the API key, which can be generated from the MWDB profile view, where you can register an API key. But for the purpose of this workshop, we will use only the password authenticated sessions. So just put the username and password into the IPython shell. And okay, the method we will be using in this part is the recent files. After clicking that up, you may see that we have different other recent methods. But we want to get the files, and files is most interesting for this exercise. And the result is the generator. It doesn't ask for all of the recent files. As you get the objects from the generator, the MWDB asks for more objects, just like the paging. As you scroll down the page, you will get more information from the MWDB lib view. So we may ask for the first object by getting the first item from the generator using the next method. So first, we should assign that generator from this method to the files variable. And we can get the first file using the next function that gets the first object from the generator. And okay, we have the object, MWDB file. If you want, you can check the name. You can check the tags and other things that are related with this object. What is important is that these objects, MWDB file and MWDB objects, are kind of magic, because if you ask for a property and it's not already cached in the object, that object will ask the API for that data. So for example, we can see what's in the cache by looking at the dict. Okay, it's pretty rich. I think we have almost everything. Oh, that was because I used the dict. Okay, never mind. But if you are accessing a property and that property data were not already downloaded, by other property and are not cached. If you use the property, it will ask the API once again for such a property. So okay, we got the file. That was the first objective, to get any recent file. And you can also ask for the next file, just like before. And that's the next file, and next, in the same manner. Okay, we have lots of DLLs from Malware Bazaar right now. To get the next 10 files, for example, we don't want to have just a file, just a single file anytime. We want to get few files, a special amount of files, a predefined amount of files. And what we have is the generator. So first thing we may do is to get next files 10 times using the list comprehension, but it's pretty awful. Okay. The job is done, but it's not elegant. The most elegant way to do that is to use a method from ITER tools called eSlice. That does the job for us and gets the specific amount of objects from the generator. What's important, it also returns the generator, but we can iterate over it and get the whole list. Let's say recent 10. And you will get the 10 next objects from the files generator. Of course, if you want to start from the beginning, you need to reset the list by calling recent files once again to get the new generator that is set at the zero point, set at the beginning, and you can get the next, the first recent 10 files from the MWDB. And hey, let's check what we have here. Okay, we have such a files. We have 10 files here. And let's check the names. File.name for file in recent 10. And as you can see, it matches the thing what you see in the MWDB CERT.PL interface. Okay, let's extend a bit that exercise, because we have also other methods that are interesting. For example, search files. As you saw before, we may put some queries here that will filter out things in the recent files. To do the same in the MWDB lib, we need a search files method. So for example, we may, it's important to start with single quote because we have already double quotes in the query. So let's filter out all the tags that start with feet to have something more interesting. Okay, as we have files, we can do the same. Is the recent 10, iter tools slice files 10, iSlice, sorry. Oh my. And check the listing. And for example, check the names and tags. By making a tuple, Okay. That was already iterated over. Oh, and as you can see, we have some file names and tags, and it should be the same as. Not this, like this one. Okay, we have got some additional files, but looks pretty similar. Okay. So let's go to the 7th exercise. And let's explore the properties. And for that, in the training document, you have a specific hash of the file. Unfortunately, I wasn't. It is not put in the cheat sheet. I forgot to do that, but you can get it from the document itself. What about getting the exact file by the hash? We can do this by the query file method, which receives, which gets the hash and the optional flag, whether it should raise the exception if file was not found or just return the none. So okay, let's ask for a specific file. And we have got the file. What about changing that parameter to something other? Okay, you have the exception object not found. So let's come back to that file. What we need to do here is to check file's name, tags, and children, get the first 16 bytes of the file, get the configuration of this file, and check names of the other files that are parents of this configuration. So pretty similar things that we normally do in the MWDB UI, but using the MWDB lib. So for example, we can automate this in the future. So okay, let's go through it together. The first thing is the file name. If you want to see the properties, you may use the tab. You have some methods and properties for your convenience. Some of them are aliases. For example, file name is the same as name. Okay, so the name is. As you see, let's check the tags. Okay, it's the dump of Ave Maria malware. And let's see the children. Okay, there's a single children, which is MWDB config. And if the children is MWDB config, there is some magic behind that will be described further. First, let's get the first 16 bytes of the file. So you can do that in different ways. For example, you can just use the content property and use the slice operator. Get the first 16 bytes. And there's also a method download, which can be also used for that purpose. Okay. That's a lot of bytes. But let's come back to the configuration. So the most naive approach is to get the first element of this list. This is the config. And let's check what we have here. Okay, we have CFG. So we can get the config. But if configuration is a direct child of a file, we have also a special property that is called config that returns the latest configuration for that file. So we can achieve the same thing. And if we want to get the parents, for this MWDB config file, config object, we can just check the parents. And if we want to check the parent names, we are doing the same thing by making an iteration over the list of parents and choosing all the names. So I can, as you can see, there are four files, not the three files like in the script. So that's the proof that system is live. Okay, I will do a bonus thing just to show you how it works with blobs, because it also might be interesting. If you get the config hash with the blob, you might do the same and use the query config method. And let's see how it works for blobs. The config returns you the embedded object, which can be accessed, and we can get the content. So you normally have JSON, but with a special object that is embedded. If you want something that is that you can easily serialize to the JSON, for example, by JSON dumps, you should use config dict, which is the raw contents of the config. The same should be written by the content. Okay, content is even better because it's already serialized. So if you want to serialize things to the JSON after download, you can use the content to get the serialized JSON form. So that's how it works. If you have any questions, feel free to go ask the question on the Q&A. If not, we can go to the 8th exercise. So let's exit the IPython by, in my case, Ctrl D and you can also type the exit command, and it should work as well. Okay. MWDB lib library is not only the library. It's also the command line interface. For example, for some manual querying in the terminal, or for your bash scripts. If you are more familiar with bash, you can use that MWDB command to make some bash magic. So okay, let's check how it works. We have different comments, various comments in the MWDB CLI. For example, the list comment. Okay, it asks me for the password for my keyring. Oh, wait, I forgot about it. The first thing you need to use for the listing of MWDB and not being asked every time for your credentials is to use the login command that will log you in just like in the IPython. So now my credentials are stored in the keyring, and they will be used in the next MWDB comments. So okay, let's start with listing the recent files, or favorite thing on this workshop. So as you can see, we have very similar view as in the web UI, where you can list some things. We have also MWDB search. where you can query for the same things like before. For example, not tag feet. And if you spot in your CLI the file you are interested in, okay, you may copy this hash and use the command MWDB get to get more information about this hash. And you have some additional info about the parent tags and child tags. It might be interesting. If you want to get the parents, there's a comment MWDB get parents, because MWDB get is a bit more complicated. You have the default is details, but you can get also children, comments, meta keys, parents, shares, and other things. So you can play with that if you want. Using that command, we can also fetch the sample to download it to the disk for our processing. And this downloaded under the hash name, but we can also use the switch keep name to use the original name. So we can now get this name and check how it looks like. Okay. We have some machine code here. Okay. So the objective for this exercise is to download 10 files that were tagged as ripped lockybot using MWDB rip CLI. So let's make a catalog called lockybot. And what we have here, we have MWDB list, MWDB get, and fetch. And that view is pretty difficult for processing. Of course, you can perform some set magic and other Linux things, but you can also use helpful modifiers, which can be listed in the help. For example, there are different format attributes like no color, no pager, no human, short. So we can, for example, use the short option to get only the hashes. But there's lots of hashes. You can pipe it to the command like head to get the only the 10 one. But it might be inefficient because you are asking the API for a list more than once, because it returns more than one page. So it's more efficient to just use the N option with a 10, and you will get the 10 hashes, 10 most recent hashes for your purpose. Okay, let's pass it to the MWDB fetch command. Using xargs, for example. But if you type it just like that, you will get unexpected extra arguments because MWDB fetch receives the hash and the destination. And it's pretty limited, so we need to give one argument for one comment invocation. So we need to add this parameter. And if we want, we may add the keep name thing to keep the original file names. And okay, our files are downloaded. In the same manner, you can get the details about all of these files. So yeah, you can also pass it pass this through gap, for example, to get only the tags. Okay, but wait, I have made a mistake because I have got all the recent files without checking if they are tagged as Lockybot. So I have failed, unfortunately. We need to use different commands because we need to search for files that were tagged as ripped Lockybot. So that is the final command. It is a bit more complicated. So we are getting all of the IDs of the files that are tagged as a ripped Lockybot, only hashes and only 10, and passing each hash to the MWDB fetch keep name. And okay, let's download it. It's a bit slow because our infrastructure is not the best one, but it should download everything without a problem. Okay, great. So we have 10 files. In addition, if you want to get some details about the file, you can pass the file path to the MWDB get. So you can get the complete information. Okay. So that was the last exercise. And that's the end of the part of about MWDB CERT.PL. So after the workshop, if you are the researcher, feel free to register because we have the registration form. But please keep in mind to use your business email, because it's pretty difficult for us to identify you when you send us only Proton mail or something. And please provide some info about yourself, because we want to know each other. We are the malware research community, so it's nice to exchange some information with the actual people, not some people behind the nicknames only. And of course, don't worry to ping us if we don't answer for a few days, because we have a lot of work sometimes and we need to be reminded if you, for example, wait too long for approval. And for you, I have also an additional hint. It's nice to add in information that you are coming from the first workshop. So feel free to add it to the additional information part. So okay, it's time for a coffee break. The coffee break will last for 15 minutes.
And so maybe before we, there were some questions about the accounts. I think you mentioned it, but just to make sure it's clear, the current accounts will be disabled after the workshop. But the access to MWDB is it's free of charge. The only thing that we need registration to do the vetting only, so it's not about spamming or anything. It's we try to keep this data TLP green, so there is some vetting that is just needed to do on our part. So all of you are welcome to change from this temporary workshop accounts to like a regular accounts that you can use later, both for getting data from MWDB and using and uploading files for analysis and getting the results of the analysis. The next part will be setting up this a similar setup at your organization or at your lab, so that now you know how to kind of navigate the interface, and you will see how to set up the MWDB and the analysis from backend, right? So if you have any questions, please use the Q&A option. If you have any issues logging in, we will not use MWDB much further, but still you can use chat for that. So 15 minutes from now, which that would be 20 past 5 our time. So it would be UTC 20 past 3 p.m. UTC. 20 past
3 p.m. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. UTC. So 15 minutes break.
Okay. Let's do the short pause. We are coming back after 15 minutes.
Okay, can we continue?
Okay, the voice has changed.
I introduced myself actually.
Okay. Because you are under my name, Steve. Yeah.
Pavel, can you confirm that we can start?
Yeah, it's. I think we are safe to start. I think you can rename yourself in the list of panelists. Yeah, you should have an option. Yeah, rename.
Okay, good.
Okay. So let's start. We have timing reminder. So we have 1 hour 40 minutes more or less maximum left. We don't want to make the workshop like longer than 4 hours total. It could be a bit tough. Maybe next time. Next part will be Jarek from our team. So I guess you'll introduce yourself and again a reminder about the question and answers. We try to answer them as they come. So if you have any questions, there were also some suggestions. So thanks for the suggestions for MWDB functionality. And the projects are of course open source. So if you may not just use the Q&A and chat, but you can also actually go to the GitHub projects and put an issue there if you find something that should be worth adding. Of course, pull requests are even more welcome. Okay, I'll not take more time. So, Jarek, the floor is yours.
Thank you. So yeah, I was already introduced twice in the last 5 minutes. So I'm Jarosław Jedynak, or Jarek, as Paweł said. I also work at CERT.PL with Paweł, with like both Pavels. And yeah, so I'm going to take this presentation from now on from Paweł and discuss and focus on the open source part of this project. So like, how can you take this service and try to recreate it in your own environment? Especially how you can run a self-hosted version of MWDB core in your own lab and integrate it with your other services and scripts. We have a project to help you like bootstrap your environment called Karton Playground that will be our tool in this workshop. And we're actually skip remotes in this presentation because we don't have enough time actually. And we'll try to explain how Maldak works if we have some time at the end, because we are not going to make this presentation any longer than we said. Okay, so let's not waste any more time and continue with the presentation. So the first part and from now on we'll be working very hands-on and we'll do a lot of exercises. So we'll start with running your own self-hosted version of MWDB core, and hopefully it will work on all of your machines because this system can be quite heavy on RAM and CPU power. So if you use a virtual machine, let's hope you have enough RAM and disk space to run it. So before we start, let's reiterate what is and what isn't MWDB core and how is it different from MWDB CERT.PL that Pavel talked about. So MWDB core is only the MWDB core is the web part, so the interface to the actual system, and this is the only system that from like our analytical system that is exposed on the public internet. So we don't like give other people, other researchers access to our Karton scripts or our other tools, but we try to upload all of our results into MWDB core. So that like this is our sharing interface for sharing stuff with other people and our main database of malware data. But MalwareDB core doesn't do any processing on its own. So this is just the front end. So there is no actual malware logic in it. This is just a smart file store that knows how to like relate various samples with each other. So when new sample is uploaded to MWDB core, it is processed in the like complex pipeline of Karton services that communicate with each other and do the actual like intelligence that, so for example, they can extract the config from malware sample, or they can extract a zip file, or they can, I don't know, download malicious URL from the CNC server and upload the result back to MWDB. So yeah. And so the question is how you can run it on your own system. So actually, so it's not very hard if you only want to run MWDB, but it gets harder when you want to start MWDB and Karton and integrate them all with each other, because they are not working together right now automatically. You need to install some plugins, and our documentation is lacking on it so far. So we've started with open sourcing all of our code, or like of all of our public code. And it took us way longer than we thought it will. So we're still not completely, we don't have enough documentation in our opinion, and we could do better, but it's good enough for dedicated researchers. We know about people who use it on production and it works for them. So if you want to try, then we're perfectly happy to help you set it up. And this is why this workshop was actually submitted to FIRST some time ago. So yeah, you can check out these two repositories on our GitHub page. And these are like the most important parts of the pipeline. So MWDB core is the interface and Karton is the core of the analysis pipeline. And when you download them and clone them, you can, in theory, you could integrate them. But it's, as I said, it's pretty complicated to do this correctly. So we've created a pre-configured and easy to set up Docker Compose, basically. So this is a service that starts all of the critical components for the system. So these are MWDB core, obviously, and Karton system, and Redis, and min.io. So four services that are like necessary for the minimal version of our pipeline to run, and they're all configured to talk to each other. So it basically just works out of the box. And if you want to start, you should clone this repository. Maybe read the readme in it, obviously, but what we'll do here is a superset of the readme you'll find there. So you can actually start by cloning this, and I actually invite you to do this right now. We'll try to do this on this shared screen, but of course you can try to do it yourself without waiting for me. And can I copy this URL somewhere to people in the chat so they don't have to type it?
I already did it, so you
can awesome. Right now, please clone this repository and basically try to do Docker Compose app, and we'll try to do like optimize it as much as possible, but it still needs to download few, like maybe a gigabyte of data from the internet. So if your network connection is not great, then it can take a while. So I'll wait a few seconds and then show how to do this on my own screen. Yeah, this was. So I have all the images downloaded already. So for me, it will be pretty fast. Wait a second. Right, so the system starts right now, and you can see that all of the services are like logging and there are no errors. If you see something different, like a service logging errors, then you can ping one of us because that's not intended. The system should start without any further configuration on a clean clone. And yeah, so if any of you are still cloning the repository, then don't worry. We'll just share, talk about what you should see when the system starts. So there are, as I've said, there are four major services. It's Redis, and this is the database that is used by the Karton pipeline. There is MWDB core, which is the interface for the system. And there is a Karton pipeline that is, right now it's composed only of two small services. It's Karton classifier that the only thing it does, it decides what kind of samples uploaded. So for example, was this an executable file or was it JS script, or I don't know, PNG image, and it shouldn't be analyzed further because it's junk for us. Or was it a Word document? You get the point. We want to know what kind of what type is the file that was uploaded, so we can decide to which services should process it. And the end of the pipeline is karton.mwdbuploader. And I have a typo on the slide, sorry about that. It's supposed to be mwdbuploader reporter. And the only thing it does, it uploads all of the extracted artifacts from analysis to mwdb. So the point of this is that you can, in theory, create your own reporter and report to a different database. So if you want to use Karton, but without MWDB, but with, I don't know, MISP or your own database or even different service, then you can write a Karton reporter, which is not a very complex service usually. The only thing it should do is to listen on new samples, configs, and blobs and report them with an API to the service that it works with, and that's it. So that's what we are doing with MISP, and it's not shared yet, but yeah, we'll get to it someday. Anyway, you should be able to click on the system right now. I hope for every one of you that there were no issues and the system works. So we can navigate to localhost and open and like a browser on port 8080, and you should see MWDB interface. As you can see, it's a bit different than MWDB CERT.PL. For example, there is no CERT.PL's logo on the navbar, because actually the logo in MWDB CERT.PL is provided by a plugin. So in a clean version, there are no plugins. So and the logo is the original one. Plugins are pretty powerful in MWDB, so you can like override most parts of the interface. But yeah, that's not what that's probably not useful to you right now. So the only thing that is important is you should try if you should can log into it with admin credentials. Hopefully yes. And right now the repository is empty, obviously, because there are no files uploaded yet. But you can see how MWDB works for admins. So you should be able to see all of the hidden panels that the regular user has no access to. You can create another users or manage permissions. I think you can lock yourself out if you try hard enough, but you please don't do that. And yeah, we'll upload files later, but right now let's check Karton playground interface. This is a very small dashboard that basically summarizes the state of the pipeline, and it lets you know if there are any pending tasks or if any files have been processed or if there are any errors. It's pretty useful when you have many services and you don't want to, like you have some errors and you want to report on them or alert people responsible for the services that are failing. So and especially right now when you will be writing your own services, you can see the errors in the pipeline, in the dashboard, and maybe restart the service, the tasks that failed. So yeah, try to remember this address. And there's one more public service. It's Minio interface. It listens on localhost on port 8090. And it's just a Minio database. So you can upload files there, or MWDB will upload files there, and they will. And it's used for temporary processing by Karton. So this is the implementation detail, I'd say. So this is the place where the normal MWDB stores files. And sometimes you might want to like check out the state of your files, and this is where they are like stored when you upload them for processing. Okay, so hopefully there were no problems with setting up the playground. And let's start with taking one of our cartons, like one of our services, and running it in your own local instance of the Karton playground. So what we're going to do is first you should create a virtual environment for Python. So this is what the first two lines are about. So this is, so you won't have any conflicts with the other Python packages installed on the system. We strongly recommend you to install all the cartons in another virtual environment, but yeah, that's not usually strictly required, but there may be conflicts. So yeah. And later, please install Karton Update Reaper. This is the service that we decided to use for a demo. We decided to open source like few of our internal Karton services, and like some of them are more useful, so some of them are more specific. And this one I think is pretty good because it may be useful to analysts, and if not too complicated, and it requires no additional configuration. So when you install the Karton Update Reaper, you basically have a new binary in your system or in your virtual environment in this case, and you can run it with Karton Update Reaper. But what you need to do is to copy, you need to have a valid karton.ini in your local directory, because otherwise you you'll have some problems with like Karton needs to know where is the Redis and min IO so that it will connect to them and download samples and resources. So these are all stored in Karton.ini. So I'm going to show you how to do this and then give you a few seconds to try to do this on your own. Yeah, let's. So first let's create an empty virtual environment. And right now I'm in a virtual environment. So this is a different, like a clean place to install new packages. And then let's install Karton Update Reaper. And hopefully it will work.
Work anyway.
Yeah, I know. So if you have errors like this, then you shouldn't worry, they're normal. Okay, it works for me. And I'll give you like few seconds to finish doing this. If you have slower computers than this, because I want everyone to follow, hopefully. Okay, and I hope everyone managed to install the package. And so you need a valid Karton.ini file. So we have one prepared in the config directory, but it's not the Karton.ini file actually, but Karton.local.ini. This is just a technical like problem because one of them works in the Docker compose and one of them works in the host machine. So we're on the host. We don't want to use any Docker containers right now to not overcomplicate things for the workshop. So when you look at the configuration file, you're going to see that Redis is listening on a port 8379. And yeah, you could connect to it right now if you wanted to. MinIO listens on a local host and on a port 8090. And you also can connect to it with your browser if you wanted to. And finally, you have MWDB that listens on a port 8080 on your local host. Yeah, I'm going to open it just to make a point. And hopefully it will work.
Just interrupted. There was a typo. One of persons Iska. If I'm not sure if I got the name right, but reported a typo in our GitHub MWDB training repository. There's one dot missing. I think we can correct it in a couple of minutes, but just a heads up.
Where is the missing dot?
Training MWDB.
Okay. Yeah, in the training MWDB on GitHub with the Karton local line.
Okay, Pavel will fix it and in a second.
I'll fix it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and as you can see, the MWDB listens on localhost. It works in this skin case, so the config works. And we can try to run the extractor right now. So all of the cartons expect to have a configuration file, as I've said, karton.ini. And this file can be in a few different locations. So if I remember correctly, they can be in the local working directory. So the first location checked is current working directory, but they can also be defined per user. So in .config/karton/karton.ini or in /etc/karton/karton.ini. So yeah, this is described in the documentation in more details, but in most cases, the easiest way to have a good configuration is typo. Is to copy to the local working directory, and if you check it, then we have a working file, and we can run the binary. It will read the configuration file from this directory, and it should work, hopefully. So we have started our first karton. And what happened is the service reported that it started successfully. There is no log consumer configured. So the logs are going nowhere, basically. They're only printed on the standard output. So it's not a problem in the workshop, obviously, but on production, you want to have some kind of a log consumer. So you'll be able to read all the errors and react on them and maybe like log the exceptions somewhere. We use Splunk, but you're free to use any other logging service. And we even have a very simple service core. I mean, the Karton's command line can install as a simple log consumer. I can show you, but Pavel first needs to I'm not good with computers. How do I open a new? Okay, I think that works. Yeah, but I'm a Linux guy. Windows scare me. Okay, so you can also do it like this. And the Karton version is too old here, actually, apparently. So, but in a new Karton version, you can just write Karton logs and it will install a very simple log consumer that will work for you. And just print the logs to the SD out, but it will collect logs from all of the services in the system. So there is a simple service that runs right now, and our Karton pipeline looks like this right now. So we have Karton classifier, we have Karton reporter that reports things back to MWDB, and we have Karton autoit.reaper that will do the actual processing. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to upload an autoit packed executable to the MWDB. And hopefully, assuming everything works, we are going to classifier is going to correctly classify it as an executable. And autoit.reaper is going to extract the file from inside and upload it back to MWDB. So first, Pavel, I need to help again. Where do you have a file or all of the files? Yeah. Right. Yeah. Outlet malware, I think, should work. Yeah. So this is the file that we've prepared for the. I mean, we didn't prepare it. Someone uploaded it to MWDB from a public feed, and we decided to use it in our workshop. We didn't write it. So, but it won't be a problem. So as you can see, I have uploaded the file to the MWDB, and the file is being processed by Karton. So the analysis is in progress, and you can actually see that Karton Update Reaper is working on it. It should be done in a second, hopefully. You can see what happens here. As you can see, like right now, all of the cartons finished their work. So the task should be done by now. And yeah, voila, the analysis is complete. And as you can see, there is a new sample here in MWDB. It's a child, added as a child to the autoit malware.bin. And if you click on it, or if you look at it, then you will notice that it's called script.au3. And yeah, you can basically see all of the, you can download it, you can treat it as a normal file in MWDB. You can also preview it and see that it is just an autoit script. And you can, I don't know, deobfuscate it with your favorite autoit deobfuscator and proceed to the further analysis. You can also upload it to the sandbox, or yeah, basically I think you get the point. So right now we have two files in the MWDB. We have autoit malware.bin. This is the file that we've uploaded. And we have script.au3 that was automatically extracted by the Karton. So this is how it looks like from the user point of view. So the user uploaded one file, and yeah, he gets a deal 2-for-1. He also gets a script. How does it look from a developer point of view? So the developer sees that after the startup logs, Karton received a new task. This basically means that it's like, there was a file uploaded to the system, and this Karton is interested in this type of files. In this case, there was a runnable file that autoit extractor decided to extract. It matched the file and noticed that it is an autoit binary, so maybe it's possible to extract it. It extracted it and basically took the data and uploaded it as a script.ao3, and that's basically all. So there were basically the script worked as intended. So Karton managed to extract the embedded script and upload it back. If the file was not actually an autoit binary, then this Karton would just say that, okay, I've tried to extract it, but this was not an autoit script. Okay. Let's get back to these slides if I manage to find them. Sorry if I'm fumbling a bit, but this is not my computer, and you know how it is. And yeah, so this is an example of how you can run a Karton service from an existing Karton service. So as you can see, this was hopefully not too hard. If anyone has any questions, then please do forward them to me or Pablo. And yeah, so we decided to open source few other services, and they are all listed on our MWDB, on our Karton main page. We're working on opening more of our tools, but some of them are could be a possible target of open sourcing, but they are not ready yet. So yeah, we're working on that. And yeah, we're also working with another people who decided to use Karton and who are trying to integrate Karton in their own workflow. So maybe after some time, when their services are production ready, they will also share their scripts, and the community will benefit. That's one of our main goals, but we'll see how it goes. So yeah, I see the question on the chat. Pavel may try to help with it. I will try to continue with the presentation. Okay, Pavel will respond to the question and I will slowly continue with the presentation. If you want to, this is basically to reiterate what I did. So if you want to check that your Karton works, then you can download the outdated malware file from the GitHub and check that it matches hash, that it should, just to for sanity. Upload it to your local MWDB and it should work. And you should see it in the MWDB. You can see that there is a relationship added because from the parent to the child sample. And you can see the sample in the preview tab. I see that the Pavel is not here, but I see a question here. The question is that init got multiple values for argument yarn rule here, and I think the problem is that the Karton should be Karton dash autoid dash extractor and not Karton dash yarn matcher. So I think that's the problem here, because Karton yarn matcher needs additional configuration. So please install Karton outdate reaper and run it with without any parameters, and it should work. First small exercise, but I expect that it's going to take a while because it's not easy to start, is to download a Karton template that we have prepared. It's basically an almost ready Karton service that you can just download and run. You can download it to the same directory that where you have all of the other samples and Karton config, karton.ini. And the goal is to change this template so that instead of do your processing function, you will have your own processing. And for example, you can create a Karton that will extract strings from incoming binary and upload them to MWDB. Before we start, let's talk. What do you see here, and what the various lines of code here mean? So first, we have an identity, and this is just a new unique ID of the Karton in the pipeline. It can be anything you want to. It's not checked in any way, but it needs to be unique in the Karton pipeline, so no duplicates here. But our usual convention is to just call it Karton dot something. For example, Karton dot first in this example, your first Karton or first, then we the Python namespace of this package is karton.first. So if you want to import some files from this single package, you just do import karton.first and PyPy package. So how would you install this package from a PyPy repository is karton-first. So these are all very similar, and it's easier to know what name are you supposed to use in any context. So we recommend to stick to this convention. But yeah, this is not required if you don't want to. Then you have filters, and this is the actually a pretty tricky part of Karton. So how does it work? So in this case, we see that filters are type must be sample and stage must be recognized. And the task that we create is of type sample and stage is analyzed. So the way it works, then every Karton is supposed to say what kind of tasks that it does it want to receive and what kind of task it wants to it is going to produce. So for example, Karton classifier will accept any file at the beginning and it will add some tags, for example, type sample to executable files, or it will say that, okay, this file is an autoid script and it will tag it as a script, or it will tag JS scripts as scripts, etc. So a different Kartons, all Kartons different than classifier, we only need to worry about files of a proper type, and the load of the system will be lower than every Karton processing every file. And for example, Karton.extractor is a Karton that is only interested in samples of kind archive, Kartons of stage recognized, and files of stage recognized, and files of type sample. This basically means that this Karton is going to listen to all of the archives. And in this case, it will extract the archives and upload all of the resulting file back to MWDB. Stage recognized means that this file was processed by classifier, and this is also a convention, so that classifier adds this stage, and like we know that we're on the second stage of processing, so there are no accidental unnecessary runs of task. So for example, when Karton classifier receives another file, it will tag it as a Word document, and the Word document will be processed by many different services, because for example, we can run a Karton for, we can write it in a sandbox, like Cuckoo. We can try to extract macros and upload them back to MWDB. We can also run analyze campaign specific Kartons on it, and for example, for a mod that there is a specific structure in the doc that we can use to extract more information than just usual macro and get to know CNC servers and other things. And yeah. And for example, the sandboxes will produce memory dumps, and the Karton will upload the dumps to another Kartons that, for example, will extract configuration. So the pipeline may be quite long in the real life. In it may look like this, for example. So we have many different services that all listen to files of a different type, and all of the Kartons send tasks to each other, and in the end, hopefully the result is configuration stored in MWDB. Okay, so going back to the filters, they declare what kind of tasks the Karton is interested in, and what kind is the task that is produced, so that Karton may decide that, okay, it's interested only in a few specific kinds of data. For example, in this case, the Karton wants to receive all of the files that are of type sample and are recognized. Another thing that I may need some explanation is that Karton base class on top. This is the base class for all Karton services. And if you want to create your own Karton service, then you should derive from it. Karton actually is just a combined consumer and producer, because the most common use case is to have a Karton that receives tasks and produces them at the same time. So yeah, you can also derive from consumer only or from producer, but most of the time you want to do both. So yeah, usually the only producer is the first is the like source, so MWDB, and the only consumer is our reporters, so MWDB reporter. And in all of the other cartons are well, cartons. And finally, we have resources. So resource is an abstraction for bigger files, so for files basically. So as I've said, the database is Redis, and you don't want to put large files in Redis because this will not end well, and the database will die soon. So we put all of the files on min.io. So this is an S3 compatible storage. You can also use, I don't know, Amazon if you want to. It will work with all of them. And resource is a class that like pretends that this file is part of the database, so it's easy to work with the files. You don't have to deal with S3 API directly, and this is like handled for you. So as you can see, you should get resource by name, and it's saved as a sample resource in the source code. Then you download it to a temporary file with a context manager, and you do anything you want to, in this case, on this file. And finally, when you want to send some file back, then you wrap it in resource, and it all just works, and the communication with the S3 storage is handled automatically. So going back to the task, please download the template. And the task was to change the function do your processing to something useful. And my suggestion, and like I think is a good suggestion for the demo, is to create a Karton that will run strings on every coming sample, get the outputs to a string variable, and upload the result to MWDB. And it's already handled in the template. So actually, the only thing you need to do is to change the line of code with the like do your processing. And instead of do your processing function, which doesn't exist, you should call subprocess.checkoutput and run strings on the file that you want to, save the result to a variable, and everything else should work. So I'm going to give you a few minutes to do this. I know that it may not be obvious how to do this at first, but you have some time. You have to restart the Karton template every time you make a change to the source code. So yeah, remember to restart the Karton when you edit the source. And yeah, and if you have any questions, please do write to me.
And so it could be useful if any of you have already completed this task. Can you just ping us on the chat so we know that at least some people had the expected result?
Okay, so if anyone manages to start Karton and get some result, please share. So, and if there are any problems also, report them. I'm going to show the solution, obviously, but first, I think it's a good idea to try to do this yourself. And yeah, maybe 5 more minutes. Okay, I saw some questions on the chat. So I'm going to show how to do this in on my own screen, and hopefully it will work the first time. So we can safely kill this service, but let's keep it running for now. And yeah, let's clone the repository or download it. So I've downloaded the template to, no, I didn't actually. I need to download the raw file. And we need to edit this line. So we can, like, the easiest way to do this is to do subprocess as Isaac, sorry if I mispronounce your name, said on the chat. This is obviously a pretty artificial exercise. And in real life, you would do this in with pure Python code. I've decided to show how to, like, do this with subprocess because in the real life you'll want to run some more complicated service, for example box.js on the incoming files and collect the results in a more complicated way than just read std out. So usually this is something like you're going to I don't know, run a sandbox on the file or run some extractor that is a script written in another language. So you're often not going to write a lot of code in the Python, but you're just going to glue another services and, like, get the results together and upload the results to back to MWDB. Actually, originally the goal was to write of these demos to write your own like box.js wrapper instead of strings, but it was a bit too complicated for a demo, and we have only 4 hours, so we decided to just use strings. But yeah, so I can. I tried to use VI, but. That's better, and we get some syntax coloring. And we're going to run strings on it. So this should look roughly like this, I think, and it should work. And we can check if strings are even installed here. Yeah, so let's check. You also want to activate your virtual environment because otherwise you won't have Karton installed. And looks like it started. So let's check if it works. You can upload a different file, but that's not necessary. Actually it may be necessary. So the Karton plugin has, is, as I've said, plugins in MWDB so are pretty powerful, and they can extend many different parts of the service, including permissions, not only the interface. So a Karton plugin has a feature of reanalyze, but it's not enabled by default for an user. But you can add it to your own user by clicking manage users and clicking your own user and clicking set user permissions. And there is a hidden permission that was added by the plugin, and it allows the user to manage Karton basically. And if you update your user, and yeah, it's then you will get another button at the bottom, and it will say reanalyze, and you can just click it, and the second analysis will start. But you can, of course, just upload a new file, and it will do the analysis again. So this is just a like nice feature and a nice way to show how nice plugins can be. So after some time, the analysis should be completed. Yeah, looks like actually didn't work here because I didn't do what I said that we should do. We should call subprocess call just calls the executable and doesn't return anything. We want to call check output, which will not print anything, but it will return the result. Yeah, that's not actually important, like in the context of the exercise. I just wanted to, let's go with uploading a file right now. Like, I don't know, bin ls. Or, I don't know, just any executable will work, hopefully. And it worked. So strings were run on the file, and it was not actually an executable file, but a bash script. But yeah, our Karton managed to process the sample and like find some data. Okay, that was pretty boring. Let's find a better file. Like maybe there is some executable here. And no, this file looks malicious. Let's give the Karton a few seconds to work. And we can see that, yeah, it worked. And we have some like strings that you would expect from in the executable. So the Karton did its job correctly. So yeah, basically that's it. I will show you the result again. So basically in this case, we called strings and got the result. In the real world, I think it's important to underscore it, to stress it. So in the real world, you would call like some more complicated script, like program on it. Like, I don't know, put it into your sandbox or run things like another scripts, or I think UPX is good example here. So when you got a file packed by UPX, you can just say UPX dash d sample file.name, and you will extract the like any executable that was packed by UPX. So potentially you can unpack many samples with few lines of code, because UPX is a pretty popular packer for some reason. And yeah, so I think that's it. If anyone had like some problems that couldn't be solved, or like the example code didn't work or something else, please share. And we shall move on to the rest of the slides, because we're running low on time, slowly. So this is the expected result. So when you upload an executable file, like setup 1061 in this example, it will get a child with a content, and you can see that the child contains all of the strings in the executable. In practice, yeah, then this would be some, like for example, extracted config, or like another data, like extracted archive content or unpacked executable and other stuff. And the last part of slides today and the last exercise will be another. So the thing we focus on a lot is malware unpacking. And we do enough of it that we wanted to do a framework for it. So we won't have a different Karton service for every malware family, because that would be like a few dozen Kartons and it wouldn't be manageable anymore. So Maldak, actually Maldak is a just a library, so we can use it for very different purposes. It contains a lot of helper functions, mostly like cryptography and compression, hashing bits, and integer objects like fixed size integers. It contains So this may look like a kitchen sink of various functions, but they were all selected because many of the cryptographic algorithms, for example, are the algorithms that we saw in a real life malware, and we don't write our code in many different repositories, but every common utility functions go into a malloc. And that's why, for example, we have RC4, which is not a good compression or cryptographic function, but it is very popular in malware. And we don't have too many dependencies in our services, but only one. We also have memory model objects. They can be used to abstract files into a memory model. So this is basically pretends that we have a executable mapped into a memory. So for example, you can load a file and load the virtual addresses directly, and it will work the same with P files, L files, either dumps or cuckoo dumps or raw files or dragwolf dumps. And this is pretty nice because you want to extract them all in the same way. So you can use the same extractor code for PF files or cuckoo dumps. And finally, we have the framework or engine for binary extraction. So this is the piece of code that allows you to write your own extractors in the least possible number of lines of code. And you can use it for any purpose you want to. We also use it in CTFs, for example, or at least people from CERT that play CTFs. But it's most useful for malware. And we're going to focus on the last two, especially binary extraction engine. So how would you create your own module if you needed to? So module looks roughly like this. So you have another engine expects to have some main directory called modules, or called anyway, but it will contain all of your modules. And it needs to have init __py file, because that's how Python works. And it's just a technology. And in every family gets its own directory. And in a minimal case, there are three files, init.py, that contains only this small line below from .citadel import citadel. And this line will import the module into Python namespace. And then you have Python code that does the extraction, and you have a rule that decides should we run the extraction now, or is the file interesting enough for us to run extraction, or is it just junk or another way of running? And you can get this from training MWDB repository. So you can just clone the repository and get modules.7zip file. But first, what will you see? So example of a YARL rule is this. This is a pretty old rule. So it still manages to catch some samples, and it was written by Mac many years ago. And it's basically public knowledge right now, so we use it for demonstrations. And you can, if you're familiar with YARL rules, you should know what this means. If not, then basically we have some metadata here, author is Mac and module name is Citadel. Citadel is a kind of ZOS module, and we have some strings like brand preps or all the other binary blocks. And this means, for example, that these strings should occur directly in the binary, or these bytes should be in the binary. You can also use wildcards, like four in square brackets means that any four bytes can go here, or eight and question mark means that the byte should start with eight and the lower nibble can be anything. And the condition is that at least three of these strings must appear in the executable. So yeah. So for example, the binary can contain a Brian Krebs string, which is like pretty interesting and very specific, and sit.solve, which is like a few bytes literal, and sit as XOR, that are other bytes, and yeah. And if the YARN matches, then we're going to run some Python code on it. And the way it works is the Python code has some callbacks like citadel found or sit.solved. And the framework will call the functions when the YARN rule manages to match this signal and this symbol. So for example, let me get back one slide. When we match sit.solved, then we'll call the function sit.solved, and this P will be the binary and memory model actually. So we will be able to use it to read the memory for memory dump. And other will be the address that the match occurred on. So in this case, this means that we're going to, like when you found bytes called sit.solved, so the bytes that YARN rule looks for, we're going to read 32 bits, so a word, from 8 bytes before the address that the match occurs. And these bytes are solved used by the malware. Why? You need to ask our malware reverse engineer. Basically, we found that, again, one slide back, when you have these slides, these bytes, and then this is a piece of code in the assembly, and 8 bytes before is code snippet that basically copies the salt to another variable, and we can reliably use it to get salt from the binary dump. And to find out what is the address when, like for this, then you probably need to spend some time with IDA Pro or other the compilers, but the like when you know this, then with Maldek it's pretty straightforward how to extract it and upload it to MWDB. And okay, so I know that this may be pretty overwhelming and I probably didn't explain it clearly enough, but hopefully it will be easier to see in practice. So please try to download the modules to your own local directory and extract the modules with 7-zip if you have it, hopefully. And finally, you can, if you have modules and you're in the proper virtual environment, you can run Karton config extractor and basically start it, and it will start to listen on from your samples. And yeah, maybe 1 minute for you to try to do this. Karton config extractor should start without any problems. And I just realized that I forgot to upload the citadel sample to the repository. So in like 5 minutes, Pavel will upload it to the training MWDB repository. So bear with me. And this is the expected result. So the Karton config extractor should start and listen on new samples. While we wait for Pavel, I will try to do this myself, basically. So first we're going to download the modules. It worked. And now we're going to extract it. Great, I think it worked too. And we have the file structure that I talked about. So we have, Python cache files that are not important. We have init.py, we have citadel.yar, we have citadel.py, and we have main init.py file. So if you forgot about the init.py files, then you like module won't be loaded and you won't be sure why. So it's important to remember about them. Now let's install the config extractor, the actual Karton. And it should install quite fast because we have all of the other parts of the system installed now in this virtual environment. It's started, right? So you can start the Karton with the following invocation. Basically, this the same as with Karton update Reaper, but right now we have one command line argument. So we need to pass modules to the Karton so it knows where to look for modules. And it worked. As you can see, it listens on many different types of tasks. For example, on Windows executables, Linux executables, and analyzes from our sandbox. And so I think Pavel managed to upload the file now. So let's check. Great, you have a file called citadelmalware.bin in this repository. So we can download it. Sorry about that again. And so this is the publicly available Citadel sample. It's from, I think, January this year. So not super old, but it's not a very active malware anyway. So you can go to your downloads folder and select it and upload it to MWDB now. And let's see what happens. So basically I've uploaded the Citadel sample to MWDB and analysis started. And I think it already finished the processing because it should be quite fast. Oh, I actually didn't. Something's going on in the background. Our first Karton is still doing some processing. Maybe the strings is heavier than I expected, but we already managed to extract config. And when we look at it, we get the very, very basic config, like the smallest config possible. So we have the type of the malware is Citadel, and we have salt. Some D word basically. And if we look at the module, we see why. And so basically it looks like the module managed to find the salt at the address that it expected. And it obviously found the main string, like coded by Brian Krebs, and it finished successfully. And if you look at the logs, you also see that it analyzed the binary and found config and logged it on the STD out. So that's basically how it works. It's easy to add new modules and edit the existing ones. We don't publish our modules yet, so because the we don't want to like, in case they are completely public, then like many people will, like some people may realize what kind of heuristics we use to detect the malware samples and change their some executables just a bit so that our scripts won't work anymore, and we want to avoid that. But yeah, but the framework is publicly available. And the very small challenge for this part, and I think this is the last task for today, is to edit the and add another function that will extract the another piece of data. Again, I like it's hard to explain why to do exactly this, but basically the rules in this YARL rule are looking for a very specific pieces of code. And for that, like you can use them to decide like that some piece of code is a pointer, for example. And when you read data from it, you'll get some interesting data. And the same happens with salt. So, sorry, with logging key. So when you get the login key from the YARL rule and read address 5 bytes later, you will get the 5 bytes later is a pointer to the string that is used as a login key. So basically the YARL rule is looking for a piece of code that is trying to read the login key to a local register, to a local variable, and then does some processing with it. And we match for this code and like read the login key with it. I don't think it's, yeah, so maybe like 1 or 2 minutes for you to try to do this. Basically, the goal is to just copy paste the seed.salt function, change the name to login key, because we're going to look for a login key instead of salt. So we need to match for a login key YARL rule instead, change the address. And instead of returning the address, we want to read a string from that address with ASCII Z function. ASCII Z. And yeah, our time is running out, and there may not be enough time to do this properly. So you can start working on it. And I will show it on my screen. It's just, Pavel, can you copy the contents of this slide on the chat too? Because if anyone wants to follow or do this independently, then it's hard to memorize all of the offsets. And I will try to do this. So yeah, let's go to the module. And when we like open it, you see that there are some, to reiterate, there are many callbacks here. And one of them is the seed.login. And this means that this piece, this single YARL rule, this string is a like a signature for a very interesting part of a binary. And basically these 4 bytes are a pointer to the login key. So we basically want to read it into a variable and then read a string from it. So it can occur, as you can see, either 5 or 4 bytes from the beginning of this string. I cheated a bit because I've picked a binary when it occurs exactly 5 bytes after the signature. So the code is a bit easier. And Yeah, so the first part we need to do is to we need to tell the framework that we're listening for login keys. So we change the function name to login key. Then we read a byte 5 bytes later. So let's call it pointer. And we read a pointer from address plus 5. We don't need any logging. And then we read. So when this code executes, then this pointer will be a pointer from memory dump. And this pointer will point us to the login key used by the binary. And we can use it to read the memory from this address. And hopefully, if anything goes right, then we'll get login key at this address. And basically, let's check. So we need to restart the config extractor because the modules won't be automatically updated. It restarted, great. Something is still processing the sample for some reason. And I think I know why. So as you can see, the file, but the binary is still being like in processing stage, and it may happen to you too. So why does it happen? So the sample is still processed by Karton.first, and Karton.first was the Karton that you've created, if you don't remember. So the Karton that run strings on the binary, and I've just stopped it, so I killed the Karton and it's not running right now. So this will hang in, like, infinitely, because the system is trying to be like persistent. So if any like Karton or server goes down, that it will remember that every file needs to be processed, and until I start the Karton again, it will wait. So one of the solutions is to just kill this Karton and like forget that it existed. So the analysis will complete, but we can also like imagine we had a downtime and the server that was running Karton first was down for a few hours, but it goes up again. And when it starts, then it will pick up on all of the tasks that were left and were pending for the previous hour. And hopefully it will finish the analysis, yeah. So this is the like the piece of so we had many systems and some of them were down for some time. So we decided that one of the important features that we want to see in Karton is persistency, basically, and reliability. So right now, when one of the Kartons, one of the services goes down, the Karton will keep track of the samples that are pending, and they like they're not lost, and you can still retry them when everything goes up again. Of course, there like it's only a finite amount of space that you can like keep in your Redis. So if you have 10,000 samples that are pending, or maybe millions, then your servers will run out of space. But yeah, you can use it to be more reliable. Okay. So going back to our edited Karton config extractor, we can try to reanalyze the sample and see if it works. So hopefully it will work. Let's see the logs. That's not the Karton that I want to look at. Great, I think it worked. No, it actually didn't. Because we got the same config again and we wanted to get some better config. So let's see what happened. Yeah, we want to listen to seed.login, and I think I lied to you. Yeah, the function name should be seed.login instead of seed.key. Because Yeah, the framework expects to, like, it gets this symbol name and it calls the same Python function. So there was no function called called login key. And yeah, right now, if I run it, it should work for real this time. And it did. Now we have two configs. One of them is the old one, is the same config as before. It was not modified. Actually, the MWDB doesn't delete anything by default. So like this old config is still here. If you update your extractor to a better one, you still have older configs, but you also get a better config, and it's just string B. I'm not even sure if that's the correct login key, but it's possible, even though unlikely that the login key is so short. But yeah, you can see that the extractor managed to extract some data from the binary, get more data and get something more. So this was a very simple example of the extractor module. In practice, the callbacks are more complex usually or get more interesting data, but it was hard to show them on the screen. And I also got a question. The question is, why do we have overrides equals Zeus in the module? So let me check, and I know the answer. So this is basically metadata. So this means that the Citadel is a special case of Zeus malware, and we want to keep track of this metadata, but it doesn't change anything in this case.
Longer answer. That's because the config extractor tries to aggregate configurations by the family. In case you have multiple dumps, and in these dumps you have, for example, two different families, one the dropper and the second one that drops malware. And the override means that the Citadel can override some of the configuration fields of the output of the Zeus module. So Citadel is able to override the Zeus configuration. It's some kind of inheritance in modules.
Yeah, basically Citadel is a more specific module than Zeus. So in case Zeus and Citadel produce the same keys, then we want to get Citadel's keys with higher priority because it's more specific than Zeus. So Zeus may have some false positives while Citadel is only working on us like a small part of Zeus malware, and it knows better usually. Great, so it worked in my case, and hopefully it worked for you too. You can see the relations, and basically in the relations tab, we see that our Citadel sample was processed by all of our cartons that we've started so far. File produced by our like Karton strings, which contains all of the strings from this sample. It's completely like useless usually, so it's not very interesting, but like that was a demonstration. And we have two configurations, the old one and the new one, and we can click on them and see them in MWDB and like read them and maybe process them later. And yeah, so in the real world, your pipeline would be much bigger than that. And probably you'll have more modules than that, but that was only for the demonstration purposes. And since we're slowly running out of time, yeah, that's the intended solution. I've actually checked in the example that the address that we're trying to read is a proper address. So it's possible that the rule was wrong and we'll read random bytes. And so to protect us from that, we're checking if the bytes are a valid pointer or not. And if they're not, then we're not doing anything. And yeah, so that was it from me. And basically, I think Pavel also finished his session. So sorry for being a bit chaotic on that, but I've tried to like explain all of the easier part of the Karton and how to make your own Karton and maybe start with the Karton playground. And
Pavel? Yeah, and everything is pretty much documented. So you can visit the links within the GitHub repositories.
Yeah, I've put all the important links on the left, so you can, we'll copy paste them. And these are links to all of our documentation and repositories that you should learn, like see if you were interested in.
Yeah, and remember to try to register your account on MWDB CERT.PL because these training accounts will be disabled. And if you want to keep the access, just fill the registration form. Put the information that you are coming from the first workshop along with your other information about your research, your identity, and the other ones. And of course, remember to use the business email if you can. Okay.
Okay, that's all from me. Pavel too.
Okay. Thanks to everyone, like all the 14 people that managed to stay until the very end. We still have, we are going to stay for a couple of more minutes here. If you have any question, if you have any question, please post it now. Most of what we have presented is open source. There behind MWDB, there are some parts that have not been open sourced yet. Especially in the second part, as you could see, these are all open source projects. So it's any bug reports, issues, feature requests, and code contributions are very much welcome. Even if you don't want to set up your own instance of these tools, you are very much welcome to contribute malware samples to MWDB. I hope that for many of you, the data that you can find there is also interesting. As you can see, that you might have noticed that it's the first time we are doing this workshop. So sorry for any rough edges. That's I think all from me as well. You have also our contact details here on the slide, so feel free to reach out after the workshop. I see that there are no questions, so I assume it's either people are tired after all 4 hours or everything was perfectly clear. Not sure which one. Okay, so thanks again, everyone. As there are no questions coming, so I hope we'll meet in person. It was supposed to be a live workshop, perhaps there'll be some opportunity soon to meet at some first event. Thanks, everyone, and have a nice evening or afternoon or night wherever you are.